Well, hey, good morning, church. Thank you so much for joining us today. We hope that you will sing along with us as we worship Jesus together. Let's sing this out.
Come, let us worship our King. Come, let us bow at His feet. He has done great things. See what our Savior has done. See how His love overcomes. He has done great things. He has done great things. Oh, hero of heaven, you conquered the grave. You free every captive and break every chain. Oh God, you have done great things. We dance in your freedom, awake and alive. Oh Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high. Oh God, you have done great things.
Yes, He has. Let's sing this out.
You've been faithful through every storm. You'll be faithful forevermore. You have done great things.
And I know.
And I know you will do it again. For your promise is yes and amen. You have done great things. God, you do great things. Oh, hero of heaven, you conquered the grave. You free every captive and break every chain. Oh, God, you have done great. We dance in your freedom, awake and alive. Oh, Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high. Oh, God, you have done great things.
Sing this out, hallelujah.
And hallelujah, God, above it all. Hallelujah, God, unshakable. Hallelujah, you have done great things. And hallelujah, God, above it all. Hallelujah, God, unshakable. Hallelujah, you have done great things.
Oh, hero.
Oh, hero of heaven, you conquered the grave. You free every captive and break every chain. Oh, God, you have done great things. We dance in your freedom. Awake and alive. Oh, Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high. Oh, God, you have done great things. And oh, God, you have done great things.
Yes, you do, Jesus.
Thank you, Father. Why should I feel discouraged? Why should the shadows come? Why should my heart be lonely and long for heaven and home? When Jesus is my portion, my constant friend is He. His eyes and I know He watches me. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know He watches me. I sing because I'm happy. I sing because resting on His goodness. Cast my doubt and fear, though by the path you leaded, but one step I may see, His eye is on the sparrow, and I know He watches me. His
God, so Sing out in your own words.
So
Jesus,
you're beautiful, God. We worship you,
Lord. Death could not hold you. The veil tore before you. You silenced the boast of sin and grave. Sing this out. The heavens are roaring, the praise of your glory, for you are raised to life again. You are God, you have no rival, you have no equal, now and forever, God, you reign. Yours is
This is how I fight my battles. This is how. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you.
It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. Oh God, what a powerful name it is. What a powerful name it is.
The name of Jesus Christ, my King.
Sing this out.
What a powerful name it is. Nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is.
The name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus. Come on, whatever you're doing right now, whether you're sipping on some coffee, maybe you're changing a dirty diaper, whatever you're doing, I just encourage you to just sing out these words just a few more moments. Can we just press into God?
Death could not hold you, the veil tore before you, you silenced the boast of sin and grave. The heavens are roaring, the praise of your glory, for you are raised to life again.
Come on.
You have no rival, God. You have no equal. Now and forever, God, you reign. Yours is the kingdom. Yours is the glory. Yours is the name above all names.
What a powerful name it is.
What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a powerful name it is. Nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus.
What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus. Powerful name it is. The name.
Jesus, we just thank you for your presence that is in our homes, God. We know that your presence is here and that you're moving. And Lord, just remind us that this is how we fight our battles, God. In these moments when we're worshiping you, when I'm worshiping you, God, and I can see my wife who's doing the words, and she's worshiping you at the same time. And Lord, this is how we fight. Because your name is great, your name is higher than anything we could ever sing out. Your name is greater. And Lord, I was reading this morning in Isaiah 45 where it was saying that there's no other gods that can save us. And Lord, if we've been turning to other gods, other lowercase g gods, God, convict us. Direct our hearts back to you. Because you're worthy, God. You're worthy of our praise, of all of our honor, of all of our glory, of everything that we can give you, God. You deserve it. So, Lord, we thank you for this time of worship. And we thank you that you're in our homes. And we thank you, God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Well, I wasn't really expecting that. Could we just give praise to Jesus in our homes? Obviously, we can't hear each other, and we can't hear our praise or our applause, but I just hope if you're at your home, if you could just give Jesus some praise in this place. He's worthy. He's worthy. Well, welcome, everyone. Welcome to Claire Assembly. We're so happy that you could join us today. I would just encourage you to give kind of a socially distant high five to your fellow neighbors in the comments. If you just want to comment and say hello, that would really do our hearts well to hear that you're here and that you're with us. Just a couple quick updates. So Kingdom Kids, we're going to have our service directly following the message. So parents, you don't have to go anywhere. You can just stay with the message, and the lesson will be there for you. Also, to our youth students, grades 6 through 12, we have our Atmos Youth tonight at 6 p.m., and so I'm going to be sending out the reminders on our Remind. And so, parents, if you want to get involved on that, you can just text me or ask for the directions there. And let me just plug that's been a really good thing, I think, for our teenagers, is to see other teenagers face-to-face on Zoom. And so, parents, I would challenge you, if you have a young person in your life and they haven't gotten involved in this, I'm very biased because, you know, this is part of my ministry, but please take advantage of this. It's a really powerful time, I think, when teenagers can see each other and when we can interact with each other. Also, I'm not sure if you're aware of this, but we are actually live streaming our service currently right now on YouTube, which is super cool. And so if you go to YouTube and you search Claire Assembly of God, you're actually going to see three different Claire Assemblies of God because we've kind of had some history making different channels. But you can look for our new logo, which is the flame, and that will kind of tell you which Claire Assembly of God to subscribe to and get involved with. But the cool thing about streaming this on YouTube is if you have a smart TV at home or Amazon Fire Stick, you can actually watch the service now on your flat screen TV, and you can gather around with your family and kind of engage in the service that way. And we've actually had some senior homes reaching out to us and saying, hey, how can we stream your service live? And now this is a way that they can do it because a lot of these homes also have smart TVs as well. So that's just something cool that we're really excited about, that we're able to stream the service on Facebook and on YouTube. Just really quick, some people have been asking how they can give. And so there's basically three different ways how you can give to Claire Assembly. The first is through the Tithely app. So if you search Tithely on the App Store, that's going to pop up, and just choose the green one. And you can follow the instructions on the screen. And the second way is if you want to send a check through mail, you can mail that to 3557 East Colinville Road, Claire Assembly, and we'll get it. And the final way is you can give on our website, which is clareaog.com/giving. And so that link is in the show notes above. And those are just some ways that you can give to the church and kind of partner with what God is doing through our church and with the kingdom of God. So thank you for that. And now we are going to prepare our hearts to receive the word.
So we can't do what we used to do. And that's hard. We can't gather in person with friends or with classmates. So we get creative. Step up. Work hard. Because at the end of the day, we know our God is faithful.
Good morning, everyone. Hey, so a week ago, God really put the 23rd Psalm on my heart for today and through the valley. And then as I was kind of praying and preparing, I guess the Lord kind of dropped an additional word, bridge through the valley. And I kind of want to reference that a little bit today. So the Miranda leadoff video where she announced that she and her husband are pregnant is kind of a bridge through the valley kind of thing. It started before all of this, and it's carrying on life afterward. I did a little bridge through the valley actually last fall, and then yesterday, kind of preparing sort of our lakefront for the arrival of little Theo. Theo is our grandson. He's 4 months old, so we're kind of putting it out there. We invited them for a Memorial Day weekend gathering, and as far as I know, they said yes, which is really cool, but I wanted to prep it. And Theo, whether you jump in the water and cry or whether you smile, we welcome you with open arms. This is also a bridge through the valley kind of thing. This is our little gather plate that was given to us by Lisa's uncle. And it's just kind of calling forth gathering. And so we're putting out there that on May 17th, Sunday, May 17th, we're going to gather together at the church location. And so sowing a seed with you, we're going to follow the directions of our governor, and we're going to be super safe. We're going to do everything that we can possibly do to make it safe for you. But our plan is initially to be outdoors, and so kind of have an outdoor celebration gathering, and I'm super excited about that. So help us spread the word. And if you've been kind of tracking with us on Facebook and you're sort of new to what we do, we encourage you to stay with us. If you have a church home and you've been tracking with us, then frankly, go to your church when they open their doors. But if you don't have a church home and you've been tracking with us and you're local, we invite you to gather with us physically May 17. It's a no pressure kind of invitation. So there's the gathering. And so my sweet daughter-in-law, Addie, made this wonderful graphic through the valley. And this is what we're talking about today, the 23rd Psalm going through the valley. And I think the key word there is through, which is why it's big and bold. And so if you're tracking along in Scripture, go to the 23rd Psalm. And my points really are just the verses of the 23rd Psalm. So the first one is, I shall not want. I shall not want. Psalm 23:1, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. And so David is talking about his own personal experience as a shepherd. that he's putting out there that he should not want, and he is a shepherd, and so he kind of reflects on it in that sense. And it's also true that basically this, the Lord is my shepherd, it could kick off every phrase of the 23rd Psalm. You just go through it, and can you put that phrase, the 23rd Psalm, there? And the answer is yes. So it's David's experience for us. And we must understand also that sheep are totally, totally, totally dependent on the shepherd. And so that, in one sense, it's reminding us how much that we need the Lord right now and that we would look to him. So I brought this little shepherd's staff for you, which is showing us just that little staff. And the shepherd leads us and guides us with how he works in the shepherd's staff. But I want to press into that thought right now that I shall not want. I shall not want. And in Haggai 1:6, the Bible talks about purses with holes in it. And really, it's an encouragement to do it the Lord's way, to do it the Lord's way. And if we believe that the 23rd Psalm, and it's all of life, right? I shall not want. It's calling us to be content. And I want to tie in also from Philippians, I have learned the secret of being content. So contentment is a learned thing, and it's a secret. Have you ever seen a contented baby coming right out of the womb and they're content? No, it's something that we learn over time. But the scripture talks about purses with holes in it. And so I happen to bring this little purse for you today. And so this is sort of a sacrifice, kudos to my daughter Jasmine. But so God is the one who provides for us. But what happens when we have purses with holes in it? That's what happens. That's what happens. And so let's believe the Lord to do it our way, and let's not have purses with holes in it. So some of the things that we're doing about that, and today I'm announcing for you a skill sharing ministry that we're starting. What does the skill sharing ministry look like? One is that we will have, basically we'll update our Claire Assembly small business directory, which we created about a year ago. And so we're going to update that. We're going to put that out there for you. And so really the thought of that is, let's support those in our church family that have small businesses. And if you're kind of part of our Facebook family and you want to participate in that, then let us know. The second part of skill sharing will be skill sharing. It's pretty deep. And so what does that mean? It means that if you have a skill that you can offer to your church family, that would be a trade-off. And all kinds of things come to mind. So a week from today, we're going to open up a way that you can go on our website and say, yes, I want to share this skill, or perhaps you have a need. So the second part would be connecting folks together. The church would simply be an information share and a facilitator, and you can talk with one another. Facebook family, we invite you to join. The third part of the skill sharing thing would be reaching out to those that have gotten laid off, and basically those that are willing to share skills, would they donate them free of charge to those that are that have gotten laid off. And that's part of really looking at life like the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want, and trusting him to provide. And so these are ways, very practical, physical ways that the church can provide, and we're thanking the Lord for it. I also want to kind of share a seed with you that my daughter Jasmine will do a concert on May the 1st, and this is for the benefit of churches with pantries in Clare County. There are three, Life Christian Trinity Center, and also Leota Community Church, and our church as well. And I said that word bridge is on my heart, and part of what's been on my heart is to be a bridge to our area. So we reached out to those churches that have pantries. They were really excited. They're going to help put the word out for us. And so it's a benefit concert for the pantries churches with pantries in our area to bless those pantries. And I know at least I've heard kind of reports of pantries having to turn away 100 families. We don't want to do that as a community. We want to be a blessing to them. And that's all part of the purses with holes in it kind of thing. And let's not do that. Let's rather purpose to be a blessing to each other. And so just thanking the Lord for that. She might sing, "His eye is on the sparrow," like she did today, which was just really awesome. And is a great reminder that if God takes care of the sparrows, he'll take care of all of us. And we can grab a hold of that great truth that the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. The second thing is green pastures and quiet waters time. Green pastures and quiet waters time. And I said we can lead out every phrase with "the Lord is my shepherd," and we can. Verse 2, "He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters." And you just have to love that thought. And it is true. I personally have really been, basically, I just feel blessed and fortunate that we have access to five lakes. And I particularly have loved getting out on the kayak and listening to the loons, baby. And yesterday we went out and we saw eagles fishing, flying and fishing, right? And there were three. So that's telling me probably that's mom and dad and junior eagle, which is just kind of really awesome stuff. So thanking the Lord. So that quiet waters and green pastures time is really awesome. And so I brought for you today a little of grandma art for you. So my grandma painted this. It's probably 60 or 70 years old. And it's showing the church. It's a little church in Nova Scotia, Canada, that is on kind of a tidal bay on the ocean. And you talk about, notice that it's on a green pasture, it's surrounded by woods, and it's by the still water. This is probably actually about 3 miles from where the bay goes into sort of what is a tidal river here. And so my point is, there is the church right in the middle of the green pastures and the quiet waters. And so you are the church. The church is the people, and we are the church wherever we are, but choose right now to have those green pastures and quiet waters time. It's a time to get alone with the Lord. It's a time to feast on what he's doing in your life. It's a time to soak up those blessings and the grace of God. And so I also brought a little moss for you, and this is from our yard, this little moss. I hope you can see that moss okay. And I brought that because I'm going to tell another Nova Scotia kind of reference that I remember as a teenage boy kayaking out to an island, the same kind of location that I just showed you. And I found a moss bed that was probably about 2 feet thick. And I just laid on that bed of moss and just kind of enjoyed the beauty of the Lord's creation. And if I didn't have to earn any money, I probably just would have stayed there, found a way to do Survivor Man out on that little island with the moss. I didn't do that. But the point is that it's kind of a go-to visualization. Christians can do meditation, visualization as well when we're doing it in a godly way. And so sometimes I'll just go there in my mind. I can't physically go there, but it's just reminding us of the beauty of the Lord and his ministry to us. And then the third is that he restores my soul. He restores my soul. Psalm 23, he restores my soul. And so I want us to see the sequence here. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. We have the green pasture time and the still waters, and that brings about the restoring of the soul. And so God is all about right now soul restoring time. And I'm going to make a shout out to MetaLodge in particular, that we're live streaming today to MetaLodge here in Clare. And part of what I feel like God is asking me to do is to be that bridge person, bridge through the valley, right? And so we kind of are looking to connect churches with any kind of senior home and say, hey, do you want a pastor to pray with you? Do you want folks to encourage you? And then actually at Metalodge, they reached back to us and said, hey, are you live streaming and can we show the service there? Well, pray over that, because that's creating that soul time that the Lord touches our souls and bless our souls. He restores our soul. Matthew 11:28, come to me, all who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. So the rest for us now is in the presence of the Lord. And then I love verse 29, take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. Don't you love that? And so Jesus is inviting us to learn from him, take his yoke, and he calls it an easy burden and light. And it's like, wow, Jesus, your burden was easy and light. But that's where we will find the rest for our soul. So let's go deeper in him and let's understand that he guides our soul. And so then the fourth is he guides us in the path of righteousness. He guides us in the path of righteousness. In Psalm 23b, he guides me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. So it seems like there are all kinds of opinions right now being put out there on the news media about, you know, the virus and such. And have you noticed that all kinds of them contradict and conflict each other? Have you noticed that? I recommend to you, there's actually some humorous stuff out there that if you want to search a little bit to kind of poke fun at how people are contradicting each other in a lighthearted way, a merry heart does good like a medicine, right? But the point there is that God guides us into righteousness. And the scripture refers to that we're to take up the breastplate of righteousness. And the breastplate, it covers the vital organs. So be a person that is being guided by him, and that we don't listen to any distracting voices. I think it's an opportunity to get better or get bitter by the choices that we make. And let's choose to hold on to that guiding of righteousness. And then the next, number five, is through the valley, a bridge through the valley. And my point actually says with no fear. And God can help us to do that, all of us. And so Psalm 23, even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. Now here we want to reflect on the fact that again, David's experience, the Lord is my shepherd. He himself was a shepherd. And part of what would happen in biblical times is that there would be a rough-hewn mountain pass, particularly on the edge of a cliff. And they weren't like our national parks where there's all kind of folks working to make these beautiful paths that are really safe and picturesque. No, this was some rough stuff that just happened over time from people walking along the side of a mountain. And when the sun would hit right, you were literally passing through the shadow of the valley of death. That is, if your foot stumbled, then it was curtains for you. But so I want to make just a celebratory comment and thank the Lord for Deb Anderson. She put out on Facebook a while back that she tested positive for the virus, and we're celebrating with her, and I'm doing this, saying it today with her blessing, that we're celebrating with her, that she's feeling really good, that she's actually back to work now, which is amazing, and that her husband, Tim, has no symptoms of the virus as well. And I share that because I feel like we need to put that out there more. We need to celebrate those that have recovered and celebrate where the blessing is, and thanking the Lord for that. Joshua 1:9, be strong and courageous, Joshua 1:9 says. And so this is a good time for us to choose and purpose with the Lord to be strong and courageous. The sixth is rod and staff comfort, rod and staff comfort. For you are with me, your rod and staff, they comfort me. And let's talk about that a little bit today. And I loved the fact, I love the fact that basically God guides us and protects us. And so it's because of him that we can push back against fear and we can push back against the lies of the enemy today. And so I'm going to hold up the staff again. And there's something about the staff. And so the shepherd, if the sheep was going astray, the shepherd would take the hook of the staff and pull the sheep back. And sometimes if a sheep was wounded, the shepherd's actually carrying the sheep on its shoulders. But the rod, and this could be used, the staff could be used for that as well, but often the shepherd would actually have a separate tool that was the rod, and this was to keep away predators. And so shepherds, good shepherds, were trained in basically combat against wolves or whoever might be predatory toward the sheep. And the beauty of it is, yes, they do comfort, that when the Lord calls to us and he reaches out with his shepherd's staff, and maybe we're leaving the path of righteousness, and God is saying, hey, come on back with me. With me is the best way to go. And so let's be open to the Lord hooking us and pulling us back. But equally, he takes the rod against the enemies of your soul that might be after us to try to attack our mind or our family or whatever it might be. And notice the scripture saying that they comfort us. So let's receive the comfort that God brings for his people. And then the seventh here is, my cup overflows. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Now, in Near Eastern culture, it was the custom that the host had really the responsibility of protecting their guests, and particularly if they were kind of from that shepherd culture. And so, you prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Now, we sang that song, This Is How I Fight My Battles, right? But it starts out with the reference to the 23rd Psalm, that you bring this table and it's in the presence of our enemies. Well, friends, I feel like there's a God thing around that verse and what God is doing in the song as well, in this sense, that God knows who the enemies of our soul are, and he's preparing a table for us in their presence. Well, like, who wants to sign up for that? It doesn't really sound like something we want to sign up for. But the fact is, God knows who the enemies are, and he's bringing his rod and staff of protection to us. The worst thing that any person can do is to be totally oblivious that an enemy is out there, right? But I feel like those enemies of fear and lying and despair and scarcity are trying to press in on people. Well, let's understand that God has prepared a table in the presence of our enemies that is for us. But then the key is to let your cup overflow, and he anoints our head with oil. And those are beautiful things, because oil has always been a symbol of the Holy Spirit. And so let the Spirit fall on you right now when you feel like you might be in the presence of your enemies. Notice that God is there. He's using his rod and staff in the midst of the moment for his Holy Spirit protection over your life. And so welcome the anointing of the Holy Spirit to come, but also that cup overflows. Now, I found the biggest cup I could in our house, and I don't even know this story. There's a little music note on this cup. I don't really know. Victoria just fessed up that she made this cup in eighth grade, which I think is kind of awesome. And I'm not really sure what that is on the front, but it's a soccer ball. Yeah. So just remember, soccer, the Lord is our keeper, right? And so you can have You got a music note here, but I'm going to use this massive cup to say that our cup overflows. And it is a way that we look at life, that notice in the presence of our enemies, the Lord wants to anoint our heads with oil and cause our cup to overflow. That's a choice that we make, friends. And so let's cry out to him to say, Lord, send your spirit. Lord, in the presence of my enemies, cause me to see that my cup overflows. I encourage all of us to start every day thanking the Lord, to make that how we live and how we do life, that our feet hit the floor and we're thanking the Lord, and to add to your thankfulness list on a regular basis. And friends, when we see the Lord filling that cup, we need to fill up on that. Let's not be a glasses half full, glasses half empty person. Let's be a cup is overflowing person. Let's choose that way of looking at life. And friends, so God hasn't changed his promises through this little challenge that we're in. Remember, he's taking us through the valley. He is that bridge through the valley, right? He's taking us through the valley. So soak up, fill up that cup. And then part of the application of that is if your cup overflows, then it's spilling over onto someone else. Let's go ahead and spill that cup over onto someone else. And clearly, it's kind of a Old Testament word picture of Jesus bringing communion to his people, that table and the cup overflows. So welcome that overflowing cup, friends. And then the final thing to stress is goodness and love will follow me. Psalm 23 and 6, surely goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. And so God doesn't say goodness and mercy will follow you except for when there's a crisis, or except when you experience scarcity, or except when you might experience fear. No, goodness and mercy will follow you all the days of your life. And so let's thank the Lord for that today. And notice that I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. And so there's a sequence. The Lord is my shepherd. You can put that little phrase in front of every phrase of the 23rd Psalm. And we're going through the valley, right? But God here is pointing us that bridge through the valley. He's ultimately pointing us that we get some heaven in this life. Surely goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, but then I'll dwell in the house of the Lord forever. And that's ultimately pointing to our journey and our experience of him in heaven. And so one final verse, and we'll pray together. Psalm 27:17, I am still confident of this, I will see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. So isn't that good, friends? And goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life. I'm going to close out with this little thought today. And so I'm going back a lot of years to the Christmas that I proposed to my dear wife. And I won't tell you what year that is. You can try to guess, I guess, on the year. But I proposed to her at Christmas time. My dad was pretty sick, and when we've been together, I've kind of told some intense stories about my family, but I'm going to tell a really good one right now. He was pretty sick with leukemia, and I remember gathering at Christmas time. He was kind of the strong, silent type, not one that was very free with his emotions, I guess. I saw him cry a handful of times in my life. He cried when our dog got hit by a car. He cried when my brother got arrested for dealing drugs. But I'll never forget the Christmas that I shared, that I had proposed to Lisa, and she said yes. Praise God for that. She said yes. And so there we are at Christmas, and he quotes the 23rd Psalm, my cup overflows. And I saw my dad cry for the third time in his life as he referenced that my cup overflows. And so, friends, I believe today that the goodness and love of God is an overflowing cup in our lives. I believe that the God of heaven is taking us through the valley, and he always will. And we can grab a hold of that bridge through the valley by knowing him as the shepherd. And so know him as the shepherd and cry out to him as the shepherd. The word says that whoever calls upon the name of the Lord will be saved. It's not complicated. We can cry out to him. But every day in our lives, let's welcome him as the one who fills our cup to overflowing. And so lay claim to that. Let it be a choice for your life that the cup of the Lord is overflowing on you. Let's pray together. Father, we give you praise and honor. God, we pray that we'd know the good shepherd now more than ever in our lives. And we would welcome, Lord, we would welcome love and goodness and love to follow us. And we would welcome, Lord, the open cup of your spirit being poured out on us. Lord, we look forward to gathering together on May 17th, following, Lord, all safety precautions. And we just pray your blessing. And we pray the outpouring of the Spirit of God upon our church. We thank you, Lord, for the little baby boom that we're having as we've had nursery full and lots of babies, and more babies are coming. And so, God, we give you praise and honor. And Lord God, fill our cup now, Lord God. We cry out to you, Lord, that we may see ourselves as being at a table in the presence of our enemies, but we pray for the Holy Spirit to be outpoured in the blood of Jesus, Lord God, that cup, but that you'd fill our cup to overflowing each and every day. And we purpose to give you the praise and the honor and the glory. In Jesus' awesome and mighty name we pray. Amen. Love you. See you soon. God bless. And my wonderful family is coming to close us out in final worship. God bless you.
Jesus, this is how, 'cause this is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how it may look. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. 'Cause this is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how. Sing that out. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. And this is how. It may look, it may look. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you, Jesus. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. Yes, God. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. 'Cause this is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how. Oh, come on, let's sing this out. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. And this is how.
Jesus, we thank you that this is how we fight our battles, through worship and through hearing a message from the Word of God. This is how we choose to fight our battles. Lord, we thank you that you are taking us through the valley. No matter what we're facing in our life, you are taking us through it to greener pastures on the other side, to still waters where you restore our soul, God. You take us there. And so, God, I pray that you take the rest of our church family there this day on Sunday or even throughout the rest of the week, God. You take us through that valley. Thank you so much, Lord, for what you're doing in our life. We love you, God. We praise you. We give you all the praise, all of the honor, and all of our glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Well, thank you so much, for church, for joining us today. And now we are going to play the kids' lesson.
Well, hey there, kids, and welcome to the Kingdom Kids Show, where we're going to have some fun. It's going to be an awesome time, so be sure to get ready to get off the couch and participate, because it's going to be awesome. It's going to be so great, so great, so great. See you then.
Also, don't forget to drop your highs and lows in the comments below. My high is now we're starting to put trim up on our windows and walls in our home. Kids, if you don't know what trim is, ask your parents. It's very hard to put up in your house. My low is that the Michigan weather cannot decide if we are still trying to be in winter or if it's in spring. Some days it's nice and sunny outside, and then the next day it's like, oh! All right, kids, it's time for worship. I'm going to need everyone listening to stand up and worship along with me. Looking at you, you know who you are. You're just standing there blankly at the screen. You're like, no, nothing is happening. I'm looking at you. Let's worship Jesus together. Here we go.
Your everlasting love is higher, higher, higher than the sky. Your everlasting love is higher, higher, higher than the sky. Oh, it's higher than the sky. Oh, wonder if your everlasting love is higher than the bum 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 bum. Your everlasting love is deeper, deeper, deeper than the sea. Your everlasting love is deeper. Oh, it's deeper than the sea. Oh, I wonder if the everlasting love is deeper than the bum 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 bum. Your everlasting love is to me. Your everlasting love is reaching, reaching, reaching out to me. Oh, it's reaching out to me. Oh, the wonder of your everlasting love is reaching out to bum, 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 bum. He's higher than the bum 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 bum
You may be seated.
All right, kids, today's memory verse is Psalms 145, verse 8. The Lord is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger and rich in love. Now let's see if I can get one of my friends to help us say the memory verse.
The Lord is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger and rich in love. Psalms 145, verse 8.
The Lord is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger and rich in love. Psalms 145, verse 8.
You know, Jonathan, I don't know if I want to say the memory verse again because I kind of have a feeling that some of the kids are just watching this video and they're not actually saying it with us. So I'm only going to say it if the kids say it with me.
Yeah, I don't know, Jonathan. I think they'll say it with me. How about it, kids? Do you think we're going to say the memory verse with my other friend who's also named Jonathan? Come on, do you think we can say the memory verse? Cool. All right, let's do it one more time.
The Lord is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger and rich in love. Psalms 145, verse 8.
Well, hey there, boys and girls. Today, I thought I would teach the big God story with my dog, Red. So, Red, do you want to say hi to all the boys and girls at home? And he's standing on my leg. Red, I don't know if they're gonna really like that when you're just licking their face. Red, now you're standing on my Bible. No. No, don't stand on my Bible, Red. No. Okay. I'm sorry, folks. We might have to come back to you in just a second after Red has calmed down. Hey.
No. There you go. That was a pretty good hi.
So, it's going to be a good story. It'll be kind of spontaneous as I am adapting to my wonderful dog and his attributes. So, but my challenge to you as I'm telling the big God story is if you have a pet at home, if you have a cat or a dog or a moose or I don't know, whatever you have at home, I would like to encourage you during our big God story maybe to get your pet and kind of curl up with them and snuggle up with them a little bit because this is going to be a fun big God story. All right, here we go. Can I tell you part of the big God story? Is that okay? All right, well, our big God story today, it comes from Matthew chapter 14. Did you know that, Red? It comes from Matthew chapter 14. Yeah. All right, you better settle in, buddy. It's going to be a good story. So, boys and girls, I don't know if you knew this, but Jesus actually had a cousin in the Bible. Red, did you know that Jesus had a cousin? He had a cousin. Anyways, he had a cousin. And his cousin's name was John the Baptist. Good. Red's kind of settling in for the story. It's good. Yes. Thank you, Red. His name was John the Baptist. And actually, in the Bible, it says that John the Baptist was beheaded and he was killed because of his faith in Jesus. What do you think about that, Red? Do you think that was nice that John the Baptist was beheaded and killed? Yeah, I'd be kind of speechless too. Anyways, so because of this news, boys and girls, Jesus decided that he had to kind of get away and he wanted to spend some time in prayer and thought. And so the Bible says in Matthew chapter 14, verse 13, that when Jesus heard about John, he withdrew from there in a boat to a desolate place by himself. But when the crowds heard it, they followed him on foot from the towns. Now, Red, I have a very important question for you. Are you ready? Are you ready? Get it ready, because you're red. All right, Red, if you found out that someone that you loved had passed away, had died, do you think it would be right for you to go and have some alone time? Yeah, that's what I thought. Yep, that's what I thought too. You know, sometimes when I'm talking to my dog, Red, I like to pretend that he can talk back. So, anyways, yeah, I think I would understand if Jesus wanted to have some alone time. Don't you think I would? Don't you think you would understand that, Red? Yeah. So, when Jesus found out about John the Baptist, he decided he was going to get away with himself. But some of the crowds that heard about his healing had come, and they wanted to hear about him, and they wanted to see this teaching that he had done. Isn't that pretty cool, Red? They wanted to see Jesus. Oh, do you hear something? Maybe it's someone coming. Yeah, I don't know. So, it says here in verse 14, when he went ashore, he saw a great crowd, and he had compassion on them, and he healed their sick. Now, Red, isn't that kind of interesting that when Jesus, he could have had an easy pass to say, you know what, I'm grumpy, my cousin actually had to die, and I don't want to talk to anyone. But boys and girls, just like I'm telling Red here, Jesus actually did the opposite thing. He had compassion on people, and he wanted to help and restore people. And that's our take-home point for today. Jesus is compassionate. Can you say that with me? Jesus is compassionate. Good job, good job. All right, Red, did you know that there's more to the story? Do you think we can tell the kids a little bit more about the big God story? Yeah, yeah. What do you think, Red? Okay, I think Red is ready for a little bit more of the big God story. Okay, so all these people, they came together and they said, you know what, Jesus, we want you to speak to us. We want you to heal us. So Jesus did that. Then it said in verse 15, now when it was evening, the disciples came to him and said, this is a desolate place and the day is now over. Send the crowds away to go into the villages and buy food for them themselves. Now this is a really cool verse. But Jesus said to them, they need not go away. You give them something to eat. Red, would you send those people away? And would you tell them, I don't have any food for you. You need to go and get something to eat. No, I hope that we would act like Jesus. And Jesus is actually about to do a pretty cool miracle. All right, it says here in verse 17, the disciples responded to Jesus and said, we only have 5 loaves here and 2 fish. Now, little Red here was actually, see his ears are perking up. He was kind of getting into some of the loaves that we have here at our house. And actually, I had some good fish the other day from my mother and father-in-law, Marty and Joy, and it was super yummy. But Jesus, he said to them, he said, Red, you probably want some of this, don't you? I'm not going to give it to you because it's human food. But he said to them, we found a guy who has 5 loaves and 2 fish, and bring him to me, bring him to me. So they brought him to Jesus. Then he ordered the crowds to sit down. And he took the 5 loaves. Are you listening, Red? He took the 5 loaves and the 2 fish. And just like that, just like how you're looking up, Jesus looked up to heaven and actually prayed to God. Isn't that cool, Red? He prayed to God. He prayed to God. He blessed the food. And then what happened was, the loaves and the fish were multiplied so that many people could eat. So many people could eat. And that was the miracle that came out of Jesus's compassion for people. He was compassionate for people. And because he was compassionate, he had the opportunity to serve people and to love them. Now, Red, I know that sometimes you're kind of a naughty dog and you like to chase deer when you smell them. And that sometimes is kind of stressful for me and your mom because you're our fur child, you're our son, and we love you. But you know what? In fact, last night, Red did this. I was letting him out to go to the bathroom. It was pitch black, and all of a sudden I saw your ears perk up, Red. And you were having deer senses in your nostrils, and you wanted to chase that deer. and he did. And I chased after Red, and in the moment, I was pretty upset with him because I don't want to lose my dog. I love Red. But you know what? I showed him compassion. I did discipline him a little bit, but I showed him compassion. And because at the end of the day, you know, he's just a dog. He can't help it. And I think that is kind of the premise of how Jesus sometimes, how he was feeling for his people. You know, like, they're hungry. They can't help it if they're hungry. They've come out here. They want to see me. They want to see God's power. And they want to see God move in a mighty way. And because of this, they didn't really plan on bringing any food with them. And so out of his compassion, he was able to create more food for them and do a miracle through Jesus Christ, through his power and his love. So boys and girls, that is our take-home point, that Jesus is compassionate. Let's say that three times together. Jesus is compassionate. Jesus is compassionate. Jesus is compassionate. Dear Lord, I thank you for today. And as I'm sitting here with my awesome dog, Red, I just thank you that you are compassionate to us, God, that you love us, that you, Lord, that you always want to be in a relationship with us. And Lord, I pray for all the kids at home, and I pray that you give them the courage to be compassionate to their family members. Maybe during this time, things are a little bit stressful because, you know, maybe we're spending a little bit more time at home with our families. But God, encourage us to show compassion to our family members, Lord. We love you and we thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Well, hey, thank you, boys and girls, for letting me teach the Big God story today with Red. I know that Red really enjoyed it, and I hope you enjoyed seeing our fur child, Red, with us. So, God bless you all. I hope you have a great rest of your day, and Red and I will see you next time. All right. God bless everyone. Bye. And there's dog hair flying in front of my face. Okay, all right, bye everyone.